approach to addressing the problems with drugs in our communities are obviously failing. What smart on crime approaches are the Dallas Police Department exploring? And I think that's a question for the police chief. So, Chief Brown, if you could.
See, it's this kind of question why I lost all my hair. I started out with an afro back in the 80s. And trying to shut down drug houses in Dallas and made me lose all my hair. So, let me explain kind of what Ms. Hill referenced about the drug trade in Dallas. Very complex issue legally for the police to deal with, and I think the public can learn a lot on how to help us. We've just kind of listened to what this whole issue involves. So a drug house is kind of the umbrella term for drugs in Dallas, right? A drug house. There's no such thing in reality. There's a drug trap. There's a smoke house, right? And then there's the stash house. And you could be seeing all three and all calling them a drug house, and you would be wrong. And it wouldn't help us do anything to resolve that issue in your neighborhood. So the drug trap, let me define it. The drug trap is where they buy, cook, and cut up the drugs and sell them. Right? So in the Harper shooting, that was a drug trap. They actually had the drugs there, cooked the crack, rolled the marijuana, cut everything up, and you come there to just buy. And so all the money's there. Every drug trap always has a lot of guns there to protect their product. Okay, the drugs, what you call the smoke house, is a house that looks like a drug house. You think it's the trap, it's not the trap. You only come in there to smoke and use drugs. But that's what you normally call on. You call us on the smokehouse. And so we go out to the smokehouse, we develop intelligence, we run a warrant, can't make any arrests except for possession, and they're right back out of jail. Because they only have enough drugs to use in the smokehouse. That's right, y'all got that? The smokehouse is where they use the drugs. It's where you see all the traffic coming back and forth. But there's only people in possession of drugs to use there, kind of the lowest charge. They don't stay 48 hours in jail for a possession charge in Dallas. And they're right back in the neighborhood. And you say to us in meetings, I called you on that drug house, you didn't do anything. You called us on the smokehouse. And we did do something. But we need you to call us on the trap house. Okay, and then the other house that you'll call a drug house is the stash house. And so drug dealers are smart, right? They don't want you to come to the trap where everything is. And the money, the dope, that's the charge that sends you to the penitentiary. So they have a house that's a stash house. And so you come to the trap and say, I want to buy. You say, I don't want all this traffic at the trap. Because then you'll start calling and shut us down. Go over to this house right here to make the big money deal. In other words, I'm gonna buy a kilo of whatever. I'm not gonna make that mid-level deal at the trap. I'm gonna send you to a stash house. And that's where we're gonna keep the larger supply. Very little traffic at the stash house. You may not ever see that at the stash house. Here's what we need from the public. Okay, because we have the trap, we have the smoke house, we have the stash house. We need you to get us information. What Ms. Hill does, sit on a porch, or what my grandmother did, you crimp up all the blinds in your front window. That's what my grandmother did. She crimped up all, you go to her house, it's just all the mini blinds are just tore up. Because she's nosy. She's nosy. We need you to be a nosy neighbor. How we catch drug dealers in your neighborhood is if you give us information on each of those houses. And you will know the difference based on those definitions. So all the traffic is the people coming to use drugs. That's what you're calling on. Okay, but you'll know they drove from the trap house to the smokehouse to use. In other words, I'm going up there to buy some crack to the trap, but I'm going to use it at the smokehouse. Does that make sense? So where did they drive from in your neighborhood? Where is the house traffic from? Or it's a walk path in the back alley. Where did the grass used to grow? And what are they walking from back and forth in that neighborhood? They're walking from the trap to the smokehouse. And why can't we figure this out? They don't just sell to anybody. I can't just put jeans and t-shirt on and look like a crackhead and go buy drugs in Dixon Circle. They don't know me in Dixon Circle. They gonna tell me they don't sell drugs there. So our undercover officers are all fighting up here to try to figure out, okay, how can we go make undercover buys? The law requires us to actually make an undercover buy at a drug house to get a warrant to close them down. And so if it's a closed shop, in other words, drug dealers are smart enough to know, somebody has to vouch for you for us to sell you drugs here. Some places are just wide open, and we close them down, whatever, sell to anybody, because they're upstart drug dealers. In other words, they can't be a closed shop, they don't have enough business. So in Dixon Circle, the last 10 years, we seized $400,000 in cash the last 10 years in Dixon Circle. What is that, 1% of what's really going through there? So there's $40 million going through Dixon Circle?
Speculation.
We don't, okay, if you say we failed at closing down drug houses, what percentage of impact are we having on the number of drug houses in Dallas? And so I'm just speculating, obviously, on, but we've seized real money, $400,000, in a 6-quarter-mile block neighborhood where 91 murders have occurred. We seized 284 guns from Dixon Circle. We need the community's help to shut down.
Respectfully, it was my question.
And thank you.
Respectfully, it was my question. And why I say it failed is because Mr. Harper is now dead. It hasn't stopped the violence in our community. It hasn't stopped the drug traffic. And so we know that the statistics are out there that 70% of drug users are white, right? But yet, who's in jail for it? Who's dying over it? They're black and brown people. And so what I'm asking is, what smart on crime policies has DPD looked into in trying to change the policies? Because obviously the policies are failing our folks and failing to keep drugs out of our community. So that was the question.
No, I appreciate the question. Thank you very much. In the interest of trying to make it more possible.
Respectfully, to I believe that you, Representative Johnson, put this together. This board does not represent South Dallas. And I am a business owner. I own 3 businesses in South Dallas. I own one on Malcolm X. I'm frustrated all the time. I have a police officer that I'm current. I only know him and a few other officers, so he gets the bad rap. The city attorney gets the bad rap because I'm frustrated about Malcolm X. I'm frustrated. My other 2 businesses are on Hatcher. I don't get so much harassment from the police. And it's not shine so bad a bad light. But my Malcolm X business, the one that supports me, that I've had for 8 years, every time I look at the news, Malcolm X is bad. You say that you want to bring economic growth to South Dallas. Well, I can tell you that over 90% of those businesses on Malcolm X are minority owned. They own the majority of businesses on Malcolm X only stay open 1 year. So when you go into saying I want to do an economic growth in that community, when do you come out and speak to us? May 3rd or May 7th? I went before the board. I went before the city council. And I voiced my concerns. They were unheard. Actually, a background check was ran on me. I've been on both sides of the law. I do have 5 felonies. I am an ex-offender. I am an ex-criminal. I am all of those. But there is such thing as grace and mercy. I'm not dead because of a grace and mercy. Also, Mr. Harper is my cousin. His mother is my first cousin. And so the outrage on Dixon Circle wasn't so much because Mr. Harper got shot. But we also know by history that great triumphs are also from great pains. He was killed. So all of a sudden, the city, something that was voiced in May, came together, so we need to make some changes. After hours, the first shift of the police department is kind of easy going. You know, we just ride, you know, you don't get too much harassment. But when that second and third shift comes in, go to where your brother's at. He was at Little World. I had to call him. He told me he wasn't going to give me his badge number. He was going to arrest me if I didn't leave. I told him, no, I'm going to call 911. And a sergeant came out and released my brother. We are not asked when we're pulled over in South Dallas about, for where is your driver's license and where is your insurance? Get out the vehicle. Southeast Division is what patrols South Dallas. Those officers, I've been in South Dallas. I grew up in Turner Court Projects. I went to school at H.S. Thompson. I grew up, so the police department in South Dallas as a whole has shifted. There are mostly Caucasian young officers that don't know. When I call, I don't call 911 when I have a problem. I call quicks. I call him on his phone and say, I got a problem and it needs to be solved. But I also tell him, you got young boys over here that you can't just keep arresting them. Before they even get 21, they have a felony, sometimes both. There's officers that I've told, you're only arresting for weed. But what are you doing? Where the officer, you're saying, I read in the paper where you said you want to send the athletic league of the police department. Officer Quiggs has a great program. He is someone that we grew up with. He's chased us. He's actually chased Harper. They've chased us. The Dallas gang unit, when Officer Russia was killed, the South Dallas community was at that funeral. We respect some officers. We definitely respect the gang unit.
I hate to cut you off, and I appreciate your remarks, and I'm glad that you were here to say this so the police chief could hear it, and y'all can be face-to-face, and he can hear these things. They're remarks that I hope everybody up here takes to heart, and I'm happy to talk to you to the extent you want to talk to me. I'm sure that I'm speaking for them. I'm sure they want to talk to you as well. I want to make sure we get to as many other folks as we can, so thank you.
Can you ask them, but can you respond to what are they going to do about investigating Southeast Division as a whole?
Okay. I'll let you respond to that, and then we definitely need to move on. But thank you so much for being here, ma'am. I appreciate it.
Sure. We get about 400 complaints from citizens a year like yours, not just about Southeast Division, about officer misconduct. We discipline our officers. If you have specific complaints, that was really broad. Can we just talk sidebar afterwards? I need the specific information about what officers you're talking about specifically. That's how we address officer misconduct, not broadly, without any kind of due process. Specifically, what did the officer say or do that was wrong? I've disciplined more officers as chief than any chief in recent history. Fired, terminated, suspended. So I hold officers accountable. I have that reputation in the department of being hard-nosed. You give me specific information about what an officer did, we can prove that it's wrong, I'll take swift disciplinary action. You have my word on that. But to broadly say the whole division is, or certain people are, I need specific information, ma'am. If you're willing to do that with me, I'm willing to address it.
Before we get to another question, this was a question I promised it actually was. Somebody wanted some clarification on a couple of things. But I also want to address the last comment. This panel was intended to be a resource panel for you all. It wasn't meant to be a representation.
Can't hear you.
This panel was put together to be a resource for you all to ask your questions of people who have the information. It was not intended to be a representation of any particular neighborhood. It was meant to be the sources of this information, the very top of their organization, so you have direct access to those folks. That's number one. Number two, we had a question from someone who wanted to know, they addressed it to the mayor, but I'll answer this. They said, where are the city council members from this area today? I don't know if you missed it, but Mayor Pro Tem and Councilwoman Madrano is here, so if you could stand up, maybe they didn't get a chance to see you or hear. But our council members are, in fact, here today. This is Pauline Madrano's district. And the other question was, were the other city council members invited? The answer is, of course, absolutely, they were. The question, again, the police chief apparently is very popular, so we have another question for the police chief before we get to a question from the back mic, and that was, what is the police chief doing to be proactive as opposed to reactive? And knowing the history of Dixon Circle, why is it that as soon as you were appointed, you did not try to build a healthy relationship between the citizens and the police? And before you respond to that, I'm going to give you this microphone. There's an article that I passed around, or I asked people to get a copy of, thank you, to get a copy of this magazine, Governing Magazine. It has an article in it that I think you should all read when you go home or when you get a chance, that talks about what a city like ours has done to improve the relationship between their police and the community. And it does involve some of what's at the heart of this question, which is the interaction between the chief and the people. So, Chief, could you respond to that?
Right, and so your thoughts of Dixon Circle may be different than my thoughts, right? So let me just explain, if you don't mind. Dixon Circle community is 85% Hispanic. Let me say that slower. I know, right now, it's 85% Hispanic. At one time, it was predominantly African American. But the transition has occurred over the last 10 years to a different community. And the people you saw protesting, most of them don't live there. And I'm going to do plain talk. And the issue is criminality in that, on that street between the Crips and the Bloods.
It is.
And that was some of the things that caused the call to happen. Mr. Johnson is a Blood. Mr. Harper is a Crip. And so that's... That was, well, I tell you, if you're going to interrupt me, it's going to be hard to talk. I didn't interrupt you when you were talking.
Can we please just let him respond, please?
They were free.
Can we please let him respond and try to keep order? Thank you. So I appreciate it.
What we've done, obviously, through our gang unit, is done a lot of gang intervention to affect the criminality there. What we've done with the Hispanic community there is reached out through Crime Watch programming. The Unidos program is an all-Spanish Crime Watch effort to grow communications in the Hispanic community, because that's 85% Hispanic in Dixon Circle. I brought back the Police Athletic League. It was dormant since 1980. I brought back youth programming in the department to where we reach out to our young people through cultural arts, facilitating 501(c)s, creating programming for our youth. I've challenged all the Crime Watch groups in Dallas to create some component of youth programming. Our chief on the beat is my effort to go into communities. I've gone into the South Dallas community, the Oak Cliff community, North Dallas, Central Dallas with Chief on the Beat, which is a collaborative effort between the department and all of the health and fire programs to communicate with people, create contacts. I personally go to these communities. My mother lives just blocks from Dixon Circle there in South Dallas. And so what have I done? I've reached out to Crime Watch, Neighborhood Watch, youth. What have I done? I've created, hopefully, a positive crime reduction effort. Crime is down 25% since I've been chief. The safest this city has been in 5 decades. I'm willing to do more, and I'm willing to accept any of your criticism so that we can improve.
Hold on 1 second.
It was my question.
Okay.
I just want to clarify. You're telling us about what you're doing in the Dallas community. I specifically asked about the Dixon community. I was born and raised on Dixon. I've seen nothing. You all don't, y'all come to the Larry Johnson Center. I don't see y'all coming out holding anything, no kind of community. I see nothing. Nothing. I'm asking specifically about Dixon Circle. I'm not asking about what you're doing in North Dallas, what you're doing in West Dallas. Yeah, those are problem areas also, but all I can talk about is Dixon Circle. That's what I know. I'm asking you specifically, what have you done since this incident has happened with James Harper? What do y'all plan on doing as far as getting, because when we see the police, all we know is harassment. All we know is, okay, well, it's a problem. It's not a healthy relationship between the citizens of Dixon Circle and the police. So what are you doing as far as the Dixon Circle community? I'm not concerned about anybody else.
I'm going to let him respond to that really briefly, but I just want to make sure I did read your question accurately. I did mention that you asked about Dixon
Circle.
I'm not
concerned with
it. But you did say after he was appointed, right? Not after this incident. That's what it says on the card.
So can you
spend a minute just to respond to Dixon Circle?
Right. We've been in a Dixon Circle community. Officer Puyi, Officer Victor Proctor, who's a sergeant as well, have worked with. If you recall the protest that night, our officers were in the crowd because they knew people. They knew people in that crowd.
We won't get through everybody's questions or even close if we keep interrupting, okay? I need you, please, please help us maintain order. Please, please. Thank you. I appreciate that, but.
Yeah, we've established a relationship with the people, and we've talked with Mr. Carter on several occasions before this happened and since this happened. We have been at the Larry Johnson Center, and we plan on coming back multiple times. I'm committed to creating youth programming in Dixon Circle. We've done it before. We need to do more of it. I accept your criticism, ma'am, that we can always do more. I accept that. That's fair criticism.
That's fair enough.
As long as you're willing to work with us. Thank you.
Okay. This conversation is not over. It's the beginning, but we got to get to as many people as we can. Sir, please.
I live in Ebon Village for a couple years now. And so the other day, there was a young officer sitting amongst a lot of the people sitting on the front row in front of my apartment complex. I was very pleased to see that. On the other hand, the only interaction I've ever had with an officer was when I parked my car and I was going to go drop off my rent money to be confronted whether I was actually dropping off my car for illegal purposes, which was a very interesting question. So my question is, you know, I live in an apartment complex and a lot of apartment living in South Dallas, and I know what's going on, for example, at Fraser Ports, and you talk about Larry Johnson Center, but how are you evaluating the police interaction in those places? You know, because, you know, I live in this community where that interaction, I can't see it happening. That's just me. And, you know, I get the notices for everything that's going on in my community. How are you evaluating the positive interaction, especially in the apartment complexes, because there's so many residents who live there?
Right. So we constantly evaluate our interactions. Most of the time, our evaluation is based on our feedback with the Crime Watch groups there. And we try to grow more Crime Watch groups so we can have organizations to go to get feedback on how well our relationship is doing. And if you're not a member of Crime Watch, I would encourage you to become a member of your neighborhood Crime Watch. That is the connection that we have that's the strongest interaction with the police department. We have officers dedicated to attend all those meetings. And the feedback we're getting is that we got to do more enforcement. The feedback we get from the council member is that there's too much hanging out, not just at the car wash, just all over. And so our actions are in response to those conversations about the hanging out in South Dallas. People just probably not from the community, what we hear, just hanging out. And our enforcement tactics may force us to ask you what you're doing, you know, or to look at you and your activities and be suspicious of it, because that's what the neighborhood through Crime Watch is telling us we want you to do. So we get legitimized by our activity, we go in, and then if you're not a member of Crime Watch, I guess the perception could be you're picking on us. But in the Crime Watch meeting, we're being driven to stop and talk to you if you're hanging out in South Dallas. That's what the community is asking us to do. And then when we do it, those are not involved in Crime Watch complain. You put the police in a very tough situation to respond to Crime Watch leadership direction, and then those that are not a member of Crime Watch, not knowing that that's the direction the community has given us, to then complain about that same action. So I just need your help in you know, this yo-yo that we're in. Join Crime Watch. Join Crime Watch, be a part of the solution. Direct our enforcement, direct our activities, hold us accountable, but get involved. That's the way we communicate with each other, is through Crime Watch. And if you're not a member, it's hard to hear what your feedback is. Through the Crime Watch leadership, that's how we kind of get directed to do things.
Okay. I have a question up here that I need to get to. I'm having to modify just a little bit because it doesn't say who it's directed to, and also it requires an opinion on the part of these folks are not in a position to give a political opinion on what they like or what they don't like. They can answer factual questions. So I'm going to tell you the question is, the Civilian Review Board, Does it have subpoena power and the ability to investigate incidents and complaints? And if not, what do we need to do to give it that power? And that's going to be directed to the city attorney. And it's not requiring an opinion, it's the facts of whether or not it does have that power and what we need to do, if that's what we as people want to do, to give it that power. Does that question make sense? Okay.
It does not have subpoena power, and that is an action that the city attorney's office cannot take. That is a matter that the city council would have to resolve. That's the answer to that. That's a matter of getting that before your elected leadership.
Okay. We're back to the microphone.
Good afternoon. My name is Olinka Green, and my question was going to go toward the mayor because of a statement that he made. So it's going to go towards you, Mr. Jones, because you sit on top of the food chain. As far as
I don't know about that, but okay.
Yes, you do. You sit on top of the food chain when it comes to this right here.
Okay.
So I'm putting this towards you. And then the gentleman at the back, the minister at the table will understand, and all the other clergy in here will understand this right here.
Okay.
Mayor Rollins made the statement about the Texas workforce and by job training programs. This is what I got to say on this right here.
We need to be a question.
Okay. Why is it that when we go to Texas workforce, there are places like Kohl's, Targets, and Walmart that say they'll hire us, but they won't hire no felons, regardless of how long it's been, misdemeanors, case by case. Okay? And then he made a statement that says, you know, there's job training programs. The doors are shut. The doors are not shut. They're welded shut, and then there's cement that's pulled over when it comes to ex-offenders. Now, why is that a person who has 3 decades ago served their time, went to college, did whatever they did, but came back and want to work, there's cement on those doors? And then I want to say this to the clergy in this room because y'all understand. When Jesus Christ died, he was surrounded by criminals. Who on this day, who on this earth, the doors was closed. But why in heaven those doors was open? But why can't men do the same thing here? So my question is, where are the job programs? Because when I go back to my community, 89% of the young men that I encounter every day, they got felonies. And so then we wonder why people like, and I'm just going to say James Harper, Tobias Maggie, all these other young men we see that are arrested out there doing street economics, because you got to feed your family some type of way. So there are no plausible, so he was saying that there are job training programs. I want to know where those job training programs, so I can prevent a James Harper, so I can prevent a Tobias Max, so I can prevent a little Ray Ray in my community. Because if you really ask these brothers, they don't want to sell dope, they want a job. Because for something that they did when they was 19, 21, they 43, 36, they still can't get a decent job. That don't stop their kids' feet from growing. That don't stop babies from needing milk. They still need. So I need to know when I go back to my community, for my community forum that I'm going to have in the hood, I need to know where are those job training programs. And like Chief Brown said, I'm going to give it to you straight. I need straight answers. Okay? Because I got people out there waiting for me to come back and say, okay, where the job training program? Because if you ask the brother, nobody wants to go to TDC.
Okay.
So I need to know where those job training programs are.
The only reason I'm cutting you off is we're running out of time. I will tell you this, we should talk about this more, but this is really not a question for them. It's a question for electeds like me, the mayor.
I told you it's on top of the food chain.
Out of respect for the people who came here to have this panel, have this discussion, we gotta let those questions go.
Okay.
But yes, the ex-offender reentry problem is a real problem, and it basically boils down to private companies making choices to not hire folks.
Well, I need a list of those
people. We will talk about what we can do and what we are trying to do at the city level, at the state level, to help. But I want to get through as many of these as I can. So
okay.
I think it's about the only one that we have time for now. But we'll do one more from up here, one more from the back, and that's all we have time for. So this question is, sorry? That's not true. Please show some respect, sir. Please. I know I love you to death, too. You know that. But you got to let us get through the format. Okay, I'm trying to read a question now. These questions came from y'all, too. These questions came from people in the audience, too. So let me, okay. Here, I'm trying to ask the question now, sir. It says, I'm going to try to interpret this, and I think this again for the police chief. What are you doing about white police killing black people? And I think what we're getting at here is there any racial component at all that's being looked at with respect to any of the police-related incidents? Is there a racial component involved, in your opinion, or that is being looked at?
Okay, this is a tough one, and again, I think the truth is...
Sorry, he's trying to talk, please.
Okay, so we've had 16 police-involved shootings this year. Eight have been fatalities, and the majority have been officers who have shot people pointing guns at them, defending their lives, and having to respond using their weapons.
Down in front, down in front, down in front, down in front, down in front.
I don't believe so at all. There's no facet support that race is involved when someone points a gun at you.
I'm sorry, I'm trying to answer you, please. And we're not going to let you shout down the panel. No one's shouting, sir, please, you are a guest in a church. Show respect.
So, some of the things that I deal with is, obviously, our homicides in this city. The majority of our homicide victims are African American. The majority of the suspects are African American. In Dixon Circle, like I mentioned, the 6 4-mile block of the neighborhood, 91 people
down
have
in
been
front.
Killed.
Down in
the
front.
Victims have been African American. The majority of the suspects have been African American. Since the Harper shooting, we've had more than 16 other African Americans killed by other African Americans. The issue is our murders, irregardless of whether an officer uses his weapon, the majority of our murders in this city is just too high. The lowest in 50 years, but if you're that family member, that's one is too many. And so we need your help in this community to help us with this issue of violence, particularly violence where the obviously in the neighborhoods that you're mentioning where African Americans are, the people killing other African Americans. And that's a tough way to say it, but it's the facts of what's happening. And that's unsustainable in any neighborhood and not acceptable. Of course, the grand jury looks at every shooting where an officer uses his weapon and someone dies. And they are independent of the police department. The police department does not sit on the grand jury. And the grand jury rules on whether or not an officer is justified in using his weapon, not the police department. The police department presents the evidence, the autopsy, the ballistics to the district attorney. And that district attorney presents it to the grand jury. The grand jury rules on whether or not that officer was justified in using that weapon.
Okay. Look, here's what we're going to do. One more question from the back, and then we're going to close the panel out. Pastor Masters, will you close that after we have one more question? So I don't know if y'all decided who's going to ask the last question back there, since I know y'all been waiting. That's all we have time for. So who wants to ask a question? Go ahead.
Okay, I am also James Harper, first cousin. My question is, okay, Chief Brown, yes. You said you're going to fire a lot of police officers, but I did study where you fired a couple of officers, but the jury put them back to work. You know, so how can we trust your judgment
right.
when it's like what you do don't matter to them because they put them right back to work? And another right. question I have, the officers on Malcolm X are all white, and I have accounted a problem with the police. I'm just a regular civilian. I'm at my sister's shop. She owns a business on Malcolm X also. Sarasso, I'm going to say his name. Officer Sarasso, steady messes with people. The young black men don't have no type of respect for the police because how can you get respect when you're not giving respect? Like my cousin spoke on, I done sit up here and witnessed several occasions where the police pull guys over. Five cars. What five cars for? They don't ask for driver license. They automatically put them out their car, handcuff them, put them in the police car, search their car, then come back when they license. When they do that, I don't understand. I don't understand why the police get away with what they do, because y'all paint a bad picture about my cousin, James Harper. If y'all knew him personally, he wasn't that person. Yeah, he did what he did, and I don't condone what he did, because, like they said, some people do what they do to eat because ain't enough jobs out here, and he wasn't a bad person. And another thing, the boys that made that false call, they was our friends. Yeah, the boys, Montrell and them, they was Chris. Hot Boy was a blue. You get what I'm saying? They all was together about the drugs. That was all false. That was all wrong. They didn't tell it right. Of course, people gonna say what they want to say. When you not on front line, on front street to see what's really going on, you gonna speculate and have your opinion. It, not all officers are bad, but majority of them is. Because I done accounted too many of them. Y'all need to see the one in Southeast Division that's in South Dallas. Those are the ones that's harassing. Why are you sitting across the street from an accessory shop asking people, do we sell drugs? Do we do this? We trying to make a living like everybody else, but because we black, because we young, we all have jobs. We don't sell drugs. We don't have criminal backgrounds, but because we young and we black, you know, it's a problem. You know, our police are not racist. Some of them are. The ones I have accounted on matter with, our police is not bad, so I'm not going to say they are. You know what I'm saying? Because I done found some good ones. You know what I'm saying? But those ones that's up there on Malcolm X, Soresso, I want y'all to remember that night, Soresso. He's the problem, and it's a good problem no more.
I wrote it down, and I'll look at it, too. Let me ask you a question about, can you trust me to hold officers accountable? I fired 32 officers since I've been chief. One officer on appeal got the job back out of the 32. The other was, others were upheld.
Okay.
You can trust me to hold officers accountable.
Okay.
The second question, you got another question, or you want me to ask you your second question?
Okay, can I ask you this? Can you please just come talk to us? I mean, it's the James Harper family that really just need answers. You know, we not trying to be mad at the police or, you know, because some, like I said again, all police are not bad. And I'm not mad at nobody about what happened. But, and I also want, I had a question too, that one of the police officers that was there on the scene, he was in trouble for writing tickets for nothing but his family. Pictures, you know, and
do you have a name? Do you have a name of that officer?
Oh,
I tell you what, let's do this. I'll agree to meet with any of your family members. Mm-hmm. Get with Sergeant Quigg, he's at the back, and you'll get on my calendar, and we'll schedule a meeting as soon as you all are available and it fits my calendar.
Okay,
as soon as possible.
Let's schedule that.
All right, everybody, thank you so much. Thank you very much for cooperating for that and working with us. We have to dismiss now, but we still have time
30 seconds.
Afterwards for folks to ask questions individually. Go ahead, 30 seconds, brother Crenshaw. Go ahead, 30 seconds.
And we're going to talk about the facts.
I love you, brother Crenshaw.
We're going to talk about the facts of why we're here, because an unknown man was shot by a Dallas police officer.
That's right.
In the history of Dallas, there's only been one person, one officer that's been convicted. And that was Darryl Kane in the incident of Santos Rodriguez in 1972.
Yeah.
I was part of the people that brought the congressional hearing in here. There was a woman named Etta Collins, an 80-year-old woman.
10 seconds.
Okay, 80-year-old woman was shot by an officer. The problem is this. If an officer violates the rules that you set down, that means that, and especially in the instance of deadly force, when a citizen is found killed, will you recommend indictment to the grand jury? I served on the grand jury, so I know how that process works. But will you recommend indictment? Nobody's ever done that. In your investigation, you find that, but I do believe there's an independent investigation.
Yes.
But if an officer is clearly violating those rules that you sent out.
You went for a whole minute?
Okay, six months into my being chief, two officers used excessive force. One,
no, that's not my question.
No, I'm answering the question.
And
there was an excessive force case in South Dallas where officers used a baton to beat a young man on a motorcycle. Y'all remember that?
Yeah.
But that's not my question.
I'm answering your question. So, I formally charged those officers. They were indicted, and they are awaiting trial. So, the answer to your question.
One officer that's been convicted, and that was Darryl Kane in the incident of Santos Rodriguez in 1972.
Yeah.
I was part of the people that brought the congressional hearing in here. There was a woman named Anna Collins, an 80-year-old woman. Okay, 80-year-old woman who was shot by an officer. Chief, the problem is this. If an officer violates the rules that you set down, that means that, and especially in the instance of deadly force when a citizen is killed, will you recommend indictment to the grand jury? I served on the grand jury, so I don't know how that process works. But will you recommend indictment? Nobody's ever done that. In your investigation, you find that, I do believe in independent investigation. Yeah. But if an officer clearly violating all the rules that you set down.
You went for a whole minute? Okay.
Well, so, saying,
six months into my being chief, two officers used excessive force.
One, no, that's not my question.
No, I'm answering the question.
Question.
And there was an excessive force case in South Dallas where officers used a baton to beat young man on a motorcycle. Y'all remember that?
Yep.
Well, that's not my question.
I'm answering your question. So, I formally charged those officers. They were indicted, and they are awaiting trial. So that.
No, you have not.
If you want to have a sidebar conversation with them, you can go that. Now we're going to pray. And we're going to leave. And you can ask your questions individually, but he answered the question the way he wanted to. So we're going to pray now. We're going to leave. Thank you all for being here. And this is the beginning of a conversation, not the end. Okay? This is the beginning. So thank you all.
Will I already have.
No, you have not.
If you want to have a sidebar conversation with them, you can go that. Now we're going to pray. And we're going to leave. And you can ask your questions individually, but he answered the question the way he wanted to. So we're going to pray now. We're going to leave. Thank you all for being here. And this is the beginning of a conversation, not the end. Okay? Just the beginning. So thank you all.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we've got a lot of work to do. And we ask that you give us all the courage and the stamina to work with one another in ways that promote the healing and the health of our communities, our entire city. We ask for wisdom, we ask for judgment, we ask for patience, and we ask for tenacity. We ask, Lord, that your spirit would be with us as we seek to make this a better city for all of its citizens. We ask for an end to brutality, of racism, the lack of understanding. We ask that you make each and every one of us, whether we hold public office, whether we're elected, whether we are citizens, make us all agents of that healing, that hope, and that health. So that what it comes out of meetings like this, what comes out of tragedies like we have experienced and in which we experience every day, is a new Dallas for the world to see. That we can get along with one another, that we can glorify you in our interactions with one another. Now go with us and stand by us as we go forth as agents of reconciliation and peace. And let what we do and say glorify you, edify and strengthen one another. We ask it all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, with forgiveness of sins. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.